for Steve Grillo right now. This is a last minute thing that I wasn't for sure if it was going to happen or not. And this is actually a big pull for me. I'm just waiting for Mr. Grillo to come on. I feel like I'm here.
Start my video.
What's up, Grillo?
What's up, Mr. Cuddle?
Yeah, mate, so you can hear me fine, man? What are you up to right now, man?
I'm on my roof. There's New York in the background.
Dude, all right, I'm going to set it up here, man. I just want to thank you for taking the time. You know, I just started this podcast because I'm at a radio right now. And I really do appreciate it. I want to thank you for taking the time to talk with me. I won't take up too much of your time.
No, it's all good. I want to thank you for even being interested in having me on.
All right, I'm going to do a little bit of setup. All right, guys, welcome back to the Tuddle Daily Podcast. And actually, you know what? I'm talking to such a big name right now, and it makes me feel like
Oh, stop.
Well, what I'm saying, though, Steve, can I call you Steve? I feel like
you
I
can call me anything. Like don't make me clutch my pearls.
Now, Steve, I'm a big fan. I've heard a lot about you, but before we get into what I want to talk about, I want people to find out about you and what you did with the Stern Show. But first, let's get all the plugs out of the way because you're helping me out and doing me a favor. How can people find out all of your content?
Well, I have the Aftershock XL Network on YouTube, which I just started. So it has my show, Grillo's Aftershock XL, which I started about a year and a half ago because I felt if Howard Stern was leaving, there was going to be a void. And I think this is the Aftershock Jock kind of idea that I had. That's where I got the name Aftershock. It's the Aftershock Jock thing. After the Shock Jock. And since the Aftershock was already taken, I went one up and went XL. So that's where the name came from. Yeah, and I just started it because I didn't realize, you know, I spent 8 years working for the show, and I didn't realize how much I learned by being there because I was just more interested in probably becoming an actor or just doing other things. And I started doing something like when this first started, and I realized how much fun it was and how much I enjoyed doing it. And I kind of got really great feedback about that I was good, and people encouraged me to keep doing it. So I finally found the right platform at this place, Pro Media, and I had a couple people backing me, and I basically just started doing it, and it started to grow, and I said, why not try to make a go at this?
Yeah, dude, I gotta tell you, man, and I don't know how you felt as soon as you started to do online content. You know, coming from a radio background, you know, it used to be people looked down at podcasts or online content because they looked at those type of people that, oh, they're not good enough to make it on radio. But now I really feel like the tide is starting to turn a little bit when it comes to content.
Yeah, absolutely, because no one can go into a studio now. And now, you know, your studio is your home. It's my apartment. It's my roof. And you can do whatever you got to do from wherever you are. Like, you're in your goddamn car, for Christ's sake.
Yes, well, no. Dude, it's not even that bad. I'm giving Southerners a bad name. I do my podcast out of my beat up 2006 PT Cruiser at a place I call the Hobo Fish Camp. So
okay, I mean, that's cool. Listen,
I mean, at least you're doing it in a dwelling. I'm doing it out in my goddamn car.
But well, you're not living in your car, are you?
Yeah, no, I do everything in my car, man.
No, but dog, you're not living out of your car.
No, hell no. Okay. But though, I really do think people like me and you that have got a radio background and we've seen what's going on, because there's a lot of these podcasters nowadays, they spend all this money on all this expensive equipment and stuff, and it's about the content. It's not about what you have, because I think the content is the most important thing.
Yeah, no doubt. You know, I try to make it interesting. I do shows like when I have guests and stuff like that. I'm also learning that I'm doing more men on the street 10-minute clip things that people seem to be enjoying. If I get a good guest, I'll have them on for an hour. It's a lot of work, and it's a lot of algorithms, and it's a lot of like the way you get people to follow you on YouTube and trend, and the numbers keep coming in. And I, you know, my producer Noah, God bless him, he, you know, he saw that you, you know, considering that you're doing your shit from the car, you got some pretty respectable numbers. Not that I wouldn't not come on your show, because I'm not like that, but it's like, you know, you got some good numbers. It's why not come on and just say what's up, you know?
Well, I mean, but I mean, yes, I've only been doing it for a couple of months. Now, let me get into, before I get into the Stern stuff and why you're popping on social media right now, what did you do for the Stern show? Like, what was your job? What were your things on a daily basis you had to do?
I spun many a plate, my friend. My job was to get there before Howard, and Ronnie would make a phone call, and I'd go down and let Howard into the building. Then I would make sure he had the daily newspapers, and then I would go down and get his breakfast. And then I would start doing the news for Robin, on top of the fact that I'd be answering the phones. And then as the day progressed, there'd be guests. I was in charge of taking care of the guests. I was in charge of getting phone calls on the air. I was in charge of so many different things. Like, the day just, on top of the fact that I was working for the Howard Stern Show and it was fun, the day just spun by because I was constantly having to do stuff. And it was just the most amazing time of my life.
So now let me ask you, okay, now I want to get your thoughts first before I give you my thoughts. What do you make of this video that's surfacing?
I want to approve a point. So this is why I'm always grounded. Watch, because my friends here, you guys give a fuck? You don't give a fuck. They don't give a fuck. Yeah, they don't
what,
give a
what
fuck.
Part of, now, do you live right in the city or where?
Yeah, I live in Hell's Borough? Kitchen. Hell's Kitchen, in Manhattan. Yeah.
Oh, Manhattan, man. That, yeah. Now, you must be doing pretty goddamn well for yourself if you're living in Manhattan.
Here's my deal. I don't have a bank account. I don't have a lot. But when when I like something, I hustle my dick off to make sure I have it. Like, I don't have much in the bank. I barely have enough, but I have an apartment in Manhattan where I have a beautiful view behind me. I have a Harley Davidson. I have a trailer upstate, and I have good friends and family, and that's all I need.
Hey, you know, you're working up there. Have you ever met Ron Bennington before?
No, but a good friend of mine is good friends with him, a comedian by the name of Jeffrey Gurian.
Yes,
who survived COVID, was on my show and told his harrowing tale of but Ron Bennington was very good to Jeffrey while he was in the hospital, but I would love to meet Jeffrey.
Dude, Ron Bennington, that's who I started out in radio with Ron and Fez. So
And Fez, okay, sure.
Yeah, that's who I started out with. So now let's get to the reason that you're on. I have my takes on this video because it's been out for a while.
It's been on YouTube forever.
Yeah.
And here's, I did not start this. I just want to make sure.
No, I know you didn't.
I know, but I'm not going to name what Whack Packer called me, but there was a Whack Packer that called me because there was somebody from the Stern camp that called him trying to find dirt on me, and I'm under the assumption that they think I started this.
Yeah. No, I mean...
All I did was get a phone call from Page Six, and I think my response was pretty cut and dry, but now that this is out there, I have my opinion, and my opinion is it was Howard doing what Howard... Stuttering John was actually just calling me.
Yeah, I lost you there a little bit.
No, I know. Stuttering John just called me. I have to call him back. No, but I wanted to tell him that, you know, because John has his podcast and he's doing really well, but he's more political based. I'm not political. I'm not neither here nor there. And but now that the way things are going, and I what kills me in life, one of my pet peeves in life is a double standard. And there's so much of that going on right now. And now that this is exposed, and, you know, like, poor Jimmy Fallon did a sketch on Saturday Night Live years ago when it wasn't disrespectful. And, you know, it's basically like Lauren Michaels says, you got to do it, you got to do it. And he did the sketch, and then it resurfaced recently. And poor Jimmy Fallon had to get on his knees and apologize. And, they were calling for him to lose his job, where Jimmy Kimmel and Sarah Silverman all did it. Okay, and they all got away with it. No one said anything. And here's my problem. Okay, it's if you're not with them, you're against them. They're all politically charged against Trump and with the right. Okay, Jimmy Kimmel is not either one. He doesn't do politics, and that makes people angry. And it's not fair to pick him out, because if it's the theory is, if you're not with us, you're against us. And since Jimmy doesn't do the humor that they do and bash the president at every given moment, everybody went after him. Because that, my point being, is the hypocrisy. Because watch the liberal, watch, and then Stuttering John made it right. Watch the phony media, and I'm not going to say liberals, because John did something really
nice. They all lie. All media lies, though.
But here's the deal. I don't want to pick a side. I don't want to have a side. My side is like logic and reason, and there's none of that going on right now. So I'm not picking a Trump side or a Democrat side. I'm picking logic and reason right now. And I made a video earlier in the day, and I kept saying the liberal media, and John called me, and this is what a good friend John is, and he's 100% correct. He's like, Grill, you know, I love you. You know, I'm part of that liberal side, and I'm not mad at you, but I know you're not. He said, so stop saying that, because it means that you're picking a side. Yeah. And it's the phony Hollywood people that I'm really disgusted with. Not the people that are for or against anybody. So I changed my speech. I changed my vocabulary because I'm not going to say liberal. I'm going to say the phony Hollywood people. That's what annoys me, that because you pick a political side, you can get away with what you want. And that's why it's not about how now it's wrong to be do blackface. But back then, no one was picketing. No one was being angry. People were laughing.
Well, I mean, I brought this up earlier in the week on my podcast. Everybody is wanting to, you know, get rid of the George Washington monuments and stuff. And I think you're talking about getting rid of maybe one of the most famous and important political figures, just the most important figure in our country.
If it wasn't for him, we would not be talking right now.
Yes, exactly. And I'm not saying it was right to own slaves back in the day, but it was acceptable back then. And I'm not saying it's right. I'm not saying it's right at all.
But I know, of course not. But, you know, brains evolve, morals evolve, people evolve. And obviously we evolved because we got rid of it. And, yeah, you know, and to oppose somebody back then, just because it was all about money and class. And if you had the power, you can get away with anything, because there was no police. There was no TV. There was no Facebook. You could, in order to get news, it took 6 months for you to get news.
Now, you know? I don't know how you feel. And the way I look at it, me and you have both worked in radio. I don't think the video that he did, wearing the blackface, you know, the Ted Danson bit that everybody's watching right now.
Yeah. Well, here's. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I don't mean to interrupt.
I don't think that was racist. We've worked in radio and we do a lot of stuff that may seem like it is, but it's more of a parody to make fun of how just ridiculous what Ted Danson did at the moment. I don't think Stern feels that way. I think it was a parody to make fun of what Ted Danson and Whoopi Goldberg did at the
time. It was, but you know, here's that's all well said and done. But going back to my point, that Howard Stern, the phony Hollywood people, Howard Stern was on The View, sitting next to Whoopi Goldberg.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
And you know, she full well know what he did on that pay-per-view special.
But she didn't blow him in, though.
Because that's what's the thing. It's a double standard, bro. He's on there, and they're kissing his ass, and he's looking Whoopi Goldberg straight in the eye and said he never used the N-word when he did a skit that was directly towards her using the N-word. Yeah. And she said nothing. But she should have been all over him like a bum on a sandwich, and she wasn't. The double standard is got to stop. It's just bullshit.
Now, let me ask you this, okay? Why do you think Stern has gone to one side when it comes to his politics? Now, and I'm just asking because I feel like he had to go that way because, and you probably don't know this. This is me just guessing. I'm not saying it as fact. But I think when he gets done with radio, I could see him doing an interview type show like
David Letterman. They tried that. They did that with E because he's such a talented interviewer on the E Network. It was just him in like a one-on-one celebrity interview. I don't know why, you know.
Let's be honest, though. He would have never gotten an interview like Hillary Clinton if he wouldn't have changed at some point. You see what I'm saying?
What's that? Well, I do. He did change. Listen, I can't blame him for change. People, again,
you got to.
Let's go back to what we were just talking about slavery. Mm-hmm. People evolve and they change because they get older and they change, their minds change and their philosophies change. So, you know, not that Howard Stern's of evolution, but we were just kind of talking about that. And like, he evolved, he changed, you know, and he got older and he got married to a younger person. You know, I'm sure they share their own beliefs. Maybe they developed their new beliefs together. He just felt like he doesn't want to be that person anymore. He also started hanging out with the elite Hollywood, which he used to make fun of. And he was never part of that crew. And now he is with the Jennifer Anistons and the George Clooney's and all these, like, you know, the Orlando Blooms that he's all become friends with. They change your mind as well, because you enjoy being around these people and they're your friends. And now you don't want to upset your friends. So you change the way you do your show. He's a billionaire. He can do whatever he wants. Yeah. And he can say whatever he wants. And he can evolve it any way he wants. Just don't make fun of the people that don't, you know, that disagree with your political views. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Now, let me ask you this. I've worked with some pretty big radio names, not at the level you have with the Howard Stern, but I've noticed that radio fans are very loyal and rabid. Are you worried about getting some blowback?
No, believe me. Well, you know what? Here's the deal. Like, I was getting some severe blowback on Twitter because people are thinking that I started this, and they're picking apart. But I'm, you know, here's the deal. A lot of Stern fans are angry and mad about what the way the show's gone. And I'm getting defended more than anything. Than when people start saying shit, you know, I Stuttering Johnson calls them Twitter idiots or Twittits. I forget what he calls them, because they're all over his shit. But he loves that controversy. I'm not someone who likes controversy. I'm a Virgo. Yeah. I don't like controversy. So I try to stay away. But I also I feel the need to, if I have an opinion, I need to state it. Whether you like it or not, I'm going to say it. So my opinion is this phony Hollywood bullshit is just getting me sick. And it just, so you can get away with it, but this guy can't. I don't like it. And I'm going to open my mouth about it. So it's not about Howard Stern being black. Like, I could have said a lot of things when Page Six called me. But what did I say? I said I don't think he's a racist. Okay. Yeah. And I never heard him say a racist thing off the air. So that's the truth. And I told them the
truth.
Well,
I mean, if he was a true racist, though, now let me ask you this. A lot of people say, and I don't think it's true because I've listened, and I know Howard genuinely loves Robin. But a lot of people think that.
He really, really loves her. And I'll tell you, like, a really interesting story. So, you know, everybody knows about Robin was sick. Stuff like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I'm very close with Robin. Like, Robin was like the person I was the closest with on the show. Mm-hmm. And I consider her still one of my, even though she's probably not talking to me at this point, I still would consider her one of the closest friends I've ever had. So when she was sick in the hospital, she called me and said, "Why don't you come and hang out?" She knew I didn't live that far. And when I got to the whole hospital room, there was a picture, like, Howard had this like really like profile picture. He's like in deep in thought.
Yeah, I think I know which one you're talking about.
Yeah, and then I went, "He gave you that, didn't he?" She goes, "Yeah." And I was like, because I knew it. And she goes, and it was the sweetest thing. He said to her, "I thought you might feel more comfortable seeing me sitting across from you."
Now, let me, can I ask you a serious, and you don't have to answer this. Have you ever felt, or has Robin ever told you she was uncomfortable with some of the racial humor on the show?
No. We talked a lot about personal shit, but when on the air, they were a team, and she kept them in check. And, you know, if she had a problem with it, she would let him know.
She would definitely say it. And that's my biggest defense. One, or a couple of things. One, I thought it was a parody to make fun of and just, you know, show people how ridiculous what Ted Danson did. But on the other hand, if Howard was a true racist, he would not, you know, true racist cannot stand people, minorities and stuff. He would not have
when he said stuff like that, he was really doing it to show the ignorance of what people did. But this day and age, you did say it, own up to it. Don't pretend like you never did it.
How do you think he, now, two questions. Will he, you know, talk about this topic? Or will he try to ignore it and let it blow over?
Your guess is going to be as good as mine, But I wouldn't be surprised if at 6 o'clock in the morning on Monday, I would be my phone might be ringing.
Now, what do you think? If this blows up, do you think Sirius sticks by him, or do you think they got too much money?
Yeah, I do. What I said, and if you go to my YouTube page, I did say I had a video where I was like, the thing is he's going to get a pat on the bottom. Like, yeah. Don't you, young man, don't you do it again. You know,
but I mean,
like,
he's too valuable, though. I mean, let's be honest. Stern.
Yeah, no, he's a cash cow. He's a cash cow.
If it was not for Stern Satellite, the merger between XM and Sirius would have never happened. And you wouldn't have had those subscribers.
Yo, buddy, I have my opinions about the way the show has gone. I said on my video, you know, and I if they do cancel him, I don't want that to happen, because you wonder why. I have a lot of friends that still work up there, and they'd be out of a job. You know, I'm not doing this to get anybody fired or anybody canceled, because like people like Richard Christie and Sal the Stockbroker and all those guys up there, I truly, genuinely love them, and they're very good friends to me, and I would hate to see them out of work. They all have families. They all got rent to pay. They're all very blessed to be up there, and I'm sure they make a fairly decent salary. And I wouldn't want to see them get canceled, because you're going to take a lot of people's lives away by doing it.
Yeah, dude. You know, like I tell people, you know, I've been working in radio for over 20 years, and this whole cancel culture happens in cycles. The last time, you know, I worked at Real Radio 104.1 in Orlando, and Howard was our morning show at Real Radio, and that's a Clear Channel station. After the Janet Jackson fiasco, that's when Howard, you know, Clear Channel was not, you know, taking any chances, and they got rid of him at that point. I don't blame Stern for being pissed off, because I feel like radio was targeted right after that whole Janet Jackson deal at the Super Bowl. And now this has happened, and this is far bigger than the Janet Jackson stuff, in my opinion.
Yeah, I know. I think what he's probably going to do, now that I'm kind of analyzing what's going on, I think what he's going to have to do, did you ever see the movie Clear and Present Danger?
Yeah, uh-huh.
Okay, there was that one moment where Harrison Ford's in the room with the president, and they were saying, deny that this guy was your friend. Yeah. And then Harrison Ford goes, no, I think it's wrong. I think you should say he was my friend, a lifelong friend. Instead of denying it, accept that he was your friend, and then they have nothing to go after you with. So yeah. I think that I'm thinking that he's probably might take a page from, you know, Tom Clancy and turn around and go, yeah, I did it. So
now, Clear and Present Danger. Now, was that because I know after a while that character, what was the character? Jack Ryan. Now, was that the Harrison Ford or Ben Affleck one?
Harrison Ford. And it was funny, weird, because I'm a huge Star Wars fan. It was Harrison Ford and James Earl Jones. So it was like Darth Vader and Harrison Ford. It was kind of cool to see them together.
Well, listen, I know you're a busy guy. I got two last questions for you, okay?
Sure, buddy. Now, whatever you want, man. What's your first name, Tuttle?
So, well, Tuttle's a big radio. It's Patrick.
Hey, Patrick.
Yeah. Now, I know from what I hear and what I've learned, Howard is a very guarded person. When was the last time you've actually talked to Howard?
The last time I seen him, it was at AGT during commercial break. And he was very happy to see me, because he hadn't seen me in years. I was a kid when I worked there. So, you know, now I'm in my early 40s, and it was like,
I just turned 40.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were, never mind. No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, congratulations. Man, I'm a radio guy. I can have my balls busted, so we're all good.
Okay, I know, but you seem like a sweetheart. But, everybody got to get their balls busted a little bit. So I saw him at AGT. I had, a really long goatee at the time.
Yeah.
He was like, oh, my God, look, you're all grown up. Like, he was like, the last time he saw me, I was, probably 30 or something, and now I'm, in my 40s. And he was just happy. He was so happy to see me, and he was like, you're not a kid anymore. You're like a man. And it was so elated. And then, but I was like, it was, in between commercial breaks. So that was pretty much the last time he saw me. The guy was good to me. Could he have done more? Yes. Do I hold any resentment? No. But am I going to tell you the truth? Yes. So every truth can seem like resentment, but I'm not taking it that far.
See, now let me ask you though. A lot of people, hear what they hear on the air. A lot of people that listen to radio think that's how people are, and they don't realize it is them, but it's like them on steroids. That's how they always like.
One of my favorite things to tell about Howard was is the fact that, like, I had to walk him up and down every day. You know,
I was going to ask you, though, is it true you saved him from being shot by somebody?
100%.
Can you go into that? Or
it was just basically, I'll try to break the story down real quick. I got there, and part of my job before getting Ronnie down there and him calling up is sometimes fans would be out there for autographs. Sometimes people would be sitting out there just to go, you know, oh, my God, that's Howard Stern. And if I saw people out there, you know, or a car out there, I used to tell Ronnie to come around the back, which meant he came to the side of the building where, like, you know, like the garbage was, and, you know. So I saw a car out there, and I told Ronnie to come around the back, and he was kind of annoyed with me. And when he got there, the guy was standing on the corner because he realized there was two entrances, and Howard was kind of late that day. And when he saw Howard, he started screaming, "Howard Stern, I'm going to fucking kill you!" And he just started charging at us. And I pushed Howard in the building. I started screaming for the big gate shut. Ronnie grabbed the guy right before the gate came down, and I brought Howard upstairs. And then I went downstairs to see if Ronnie was okay. And luckily, the marshals, I guess that's where they had their morning coffee, on Madison and 58th Street. And they happened to see what was going on, and they grabbed the guy. And when I went downstairs, the guy was handcuffed on the hood of the car and there was a shotgun on the roof with 15 shells.
Oh, man. Holy crap. Now, before we go, this isn't related. Have you guys had any problem with the rioters and looters and stuff?
Yeah,
where you're at right
now? it's like downtown Beirut.
Oh, it is.
Yeah, for health insurance and shit like that, I do beer and liquor sales downtown. You know, just like, yo, they destroyed 34. Like, everything's boarded up. Like, I video of shit that went downtown. Like they broke into fucking delis. They destroyed everything. These poor people, they've already been crippled enough with the no money. And insurance does not cover riots and acts of violence.
Nope.
So they're going to have to eat all this. And it's a ploy to keep people down. I really do think this whole thing is an orchestrated thing. It's so well calculated. There is such a narrative that is being played out, and they're doing it, and it's all to keep Trump out of office. They lost the Russian thing. They lost the impeachment thing. Now they're doing – at this point, I'm starting to think this is something bigger, because it just – this happens. Now this happens. Now there's race riots, and now we can't go out. Now they're going to extend it more. We can't make money. You have to stay in. You have to – like, it's something else. I think it's bigger than all of us. That's another thing that I could bring up. There's going to be a show – my first new show on the Aftershock XL network is going to be called The Alarmist. It's going to be starring two journalists, one of them which you probably know. One of them is my friend Jesse Nash, who's been a journalist in New York on the scene for 25 years. And the other one's going to be Mr. George Flowers, who was part of the Howard 101 team. And it's going to be conspiracy. It's The Alarmist, conspiracy theory, and coffee. And that's they're going to tape tomorrow, and I think it's going to be up Monday morning. And it's just about debunking all this crazy shit that's going on.
Well, listen, I'm not the biggest conspiracy theory guy, but with everything that's been happening, I do believe. I'm worried the last thing we need in this horrible year of 2020 is problems with the election, because I think that's going to be the straw that breaks the camel's back, in my opinion, because that's just not going to be one race or anything like that. That's going to be, everybody's going to be pissed one way or the other.
It's going to be really difficult come November. I'm always well armed.
Well, wait a minute though. All right, how does that work though?
I've always carried a knife on me since I was 10 years old.
Yeah, but the great thing about Florida, man, is they basically try to give you money to take a gun so you can stand your ground down here. So
I have the ability to stand my ground. It's just, you know, but when you're overwhelmed with like 1,000 people, it's, you know. Yeah. But I have a good core group of friends that we're all close. We all live here in Hell's Kitchen. They're all sitting, chilling on my roof right now. And I got a good backup team, man.
Well, good. Hey, man. Steve, I can't thank you enough for coming on my show. Let everybody know how they can find all your content online.
Steve Gorilla on Twitter, Grillovator on Instagram, my Grillo's Aftershock XL Facebook page. Now there's the Aftershock XL Network on YouTube, formerly Grillo's Aftershock XL Network. I'm going to be bringing some more programming. Again, we got Jesse Nash and George Flowers, The Alarmist, Conspiracy Theories and Coffee. They should be debuting Monday morning. And my show, you don't know what's going to happen. I do different things. I try to keep things different. I do man on the street shit. I do interviews with people if I get somebody that wants to come on and do interviews. And it's just, my thing is, I have a bunch of eclectic friends, and I do whatever the hell I want because it's just interesting.
Well, Steve, I admire your hustle. I really do. I think you're killing it right now. And if there's anything I can ever do for you, your producer has my number. So Okay. Feel free to reach out anytime.
Patrick, that goes the same way for me, buddy.
All right, man. Thank you so much. I was honored to have you on, man. And I hope everything works out for you. And the Stern fans don't bust your balls too much.
There's good and bad in everybody. I hope they could all find the line and be good and come and join me on my journey.
All right, man. Steve, thank you. I owe you one, man.
No, you don't. And it's all good. Be safe. Hope you and your family are good.
All right, man. Thanks. You too.
Right.
Bye.